to this mix of boys that God gave us a little girl, not simply because of who she is and what her disposition and personality is like, but just because the experience itself is so different with little girls compared to little boys. For one thing, we got to experience things like dresses and dolls and bows compared to like dirty socks and ripped blue jeans. So that's different. Beyond that, the experience of Christmas is different as well because of the gifts that you're able to be a part of, to give, or to observe. For example, this past Christmas, Catherine got an Easy-Bake oven. And these have been around for a long time, but Catherine got an Easy-Bake oven. And the first batch of cookies that was made with this, Caroline had helped Catherine with. And Caroline informed me that the next time I was going to get the wonderful opportunity to do this. And I thought, well, this is no big deal because it comes with a pre-made mix. You just put in whatever amount of water it is, and this is no big deal. Piece of cake, or in this case, piece of cookie. Anyway, in spite of my confidence, in spite of my assurance that this was going to be no big deal for me, Caroline felt it important to pass on to me a few tips before I actually got started. She said, first of all, this oven needs to heat up for something in excess of 20 minutes. Apparently, with the changes in energy laws, you can't get a light bulb these days that's hot enough to actually cook anything. And so it takes forever to heat up. Secondly, she said, add only the amount of water that it calls for, and even though it's going to look like little more than wet sand, don't add any more water to it than that. And then she said, don't be surprised once you've made them up that they're about the size of your thumbnail. Okay, so I hear all of that. And Catherine and I start, and so I cut open this package for the pre-made mix, and it says to add a teaspoon and a half of water. I put that in there, and I start trying to mix this together, and I'm thinking, that's just not enough water. It's just not. It needs a total of 3 teaspoons of water. So that can't be right, so I doubled it. You know what? It was right. And Caroline was right. I don't know if you've ever considered how difficult it is to make or bake cookies that are the consistency of cake batter using the heat from an LED light bulb. You might not have considered that, but if you want to know how easy that works out, just let me know. But I did that telling myself this: I can just figure this out. I can just figure this out. You know, so many times in life, we operate with that same mentality and that same premise. Whatever the challenge, whatever the obstacle is, whatever circumstance it is that we're facing, so many times we just tell ourselves, no big deal, I can just figure this out. Through a process of trial and error, some successes and failures, I'm just going to kind of navigate these waters and figure this out. The problem is that with virtually every circumstance that we face like this, there are going to be some instructions that are available, some things that you need to know, that you can know and you should know before you get started so that you don't just wind up making a mess as you try to figure it out. Last week we began a series looking at the life of Elijah, and it's called Learning to Lean. The premise of this series is really simple, and it's this: God can and is willing to work in the lives of people who are willing to learn to lean on and depend on Him. And in that very simple thought, there's amazingly good news, which is this: God wants to use you. God wants to work through you. He doesn't have to, but He's chosen that He wants to do this. That's great news. Now, the caveat is this: He works through only those who learn to lean and depend on Him. What I want you to know is that's not something that God ever intended for you to just kind of figure out on your own through trial and error. He has afforded us some instructions. He's given to us some information that will prepare us. And if we can get some principles straight in our mind, we can become one of those people through whom God can work. So if your desire is to see God work through you and there's some stuff that you should know beforehand, what exactly is it you need to know? We see the answer to that question today in 1 Kings chapter 17. 1 Kings chapter 17, if you would look with me in your Bibles there today. 1 Kings 17, we'll begin reading with verse number 1. There we're told that Elijah the Tishbite of Tishbe in Gilead said to Ahab, "As the Lord the God of Israel lives, before whom I stand, there shall be neither dew nor rain these years except by my word." And the word of the Lord then came to him, "Depart from here, turn eastward and hide yourself by the brook Cherith, which is east of the Jordan. You shall drink from the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed you there." So he went and did according to the word of the Lord. He went and lived by the brook Cherith that is east of the Jordan. Elijah is someone through whom God was able to work. Elijah was somebody that God was able to use because Elijah came to understand what's involved in leaning on and depending on God. That being said, last week we looked at the cultural and the spiritual backdrop that was existing in Elijah's day. And you remember we talked about that Israel at this point is led by a king named Ahab and his wife Jezebel. And this is a dastardly duo. I mean, they are despicable people, awful, just terrible, lousy. You know, so many times we say, so-and-so, that's good people. Well, these are the opposite. These are really, really, really bad people. Among other things, both Ahab and Jezebel are deeply committed to the worship of idols. And because they're in the position of leadership of the nation, again, this is the nation of the people of God, the people that God said, "I will be your God and you'll be my people." But they're not at all acting like God's people. They're following the lead of Ahab and Jezebel, and idol worship is the rule of the day in Israel. Things are bad, really, really bad. And it's into this scene that Elijah steps onto the pages of Scripture. Now, in that context and into this reality, there is, and hopefully you can notice it, some really, really good news. Some really good news. And here it is. God would have been perfectly justified, and it would have been logical, it would have been reasonable, it would have been a plausible thing for God to have done to say, "You know what? I am sick and tired of these people, my people who are supposed to act like my people, and it's not simply that they're just not paying enough attention to me, they've completely turned their backs on me, and if they ever turn this way, it's only enough to wave a fist as they bow their hearts and as they bow their lives before idols." God would have been very justified in just washing his hands of them. But you know what the good news is? He didn't. God raised up someone like Elijah to go to them. God raised up somebody like Elijah to be somebody that he could work through to try and draw his people back into himself. And the good news in that for me and for you is this. It may be this morning that you would say, "You know, in terms of me and my relationship and walk with God, things have gotten a bit off the rails. And there's some distance between me and God." And God would be perfectly justified in saying, I've had it with you. I'm done. That's it. I'm moving on to greener pastures. I'm going to find somebody else." But the good news is that God doesn't do that. God's not interested in walking away from you. God is interested in pursuing you and drawing you back to himself. That's exactly what he was going to do with his people in Elijah's day. And in verse 1, we're finally introduced to him. He's a no-name guy from a no-name place. But God is getting ready to work through him. And why is that? Because Elijah understood a few principles, and the first is this. You've got to understand the chain of command. You've just got to understand the chain of command. Now, if you're content to just sit on the bench and just show up at church and that's it, if you're content for God to never use you to impact circumstances, to impact other people, to make a difference in your family, this community, or anywhere else in the world, fine. Sit like a lump on a log. But if you want God to work and use you and to work through you, you've got to understand the chain of command. Oh, what do I mean by that? Well, look what's going on here in verse 1. Elijah gets this audience with the king. He is able to get an opportunity to have a conversation with Ahab. And once he gets that opportunity, you see it in verse 1, what he says. He says, "As the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, before whom I stand, there will neither be dew or rain these years except by my word." So Elijah is showing up to announce a drought, but not just any old drought. This is a drought of epic proportions. And it is not merely that there is not going to be rain, there's not going to be even dew. And it's not for a period of weeks or even for a period of months, but he uses the word intentionally, years. And then goes so far as to say, not only is it not going to rain, nor is there going to be any dew for years, you won't see any rain until it is, I show back up and announce it. Now, that's the message. That's the message. God's getting ready to turn the spigot off, and things are going to get dry, really, really dry. In the understanding of the message, it's very easy to lose sight of a very simple statement that you see in what Elijah says. It is not merely that he is conveying a message, but he gives the foundation for the message, the reason for which it is that he's able to say these things. You see it in verse 1. He says, as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives. And then he says this, before whom I stand. Elijah doesn't just show up as Joe Blow off the street and say, hey king, you better get ready because the faucet's getting ready to be turned off. He announces to the king the basis upon which he appears before him. Now again, this is simple, but it's really important. For you to be somebody through whom God can work, if your life is one that God can use, you've got to understand the chain of command. You've got to understand who it is that you are working for. And you're not working for your spouse. You are not working for your teacher. You're not working for your preacher. You're not working for your boss. You're not working for your neighbor. You're not ultimately working for any of those people. If you're a follower of Christ that wants to see God work through you, you understand this. I ultimately work for and I serve Him. And it is ultimately before Him that I stand, and it is ultimately before Him that one day I will stand to give an account. You say, well, what difference does that make? Well, there's a slew of different reasons, but this is a really important one. When you as an individual, as a follower of Christ, operate with the awareness that I stand and ultimately will stand before the Lord, then the tasks that He gives you, that He assigns you, the plans that He wants to accomplish through you, don't simply come to you as a to-do list. They come as opportunities about which there is a sense of a moral imperative. I must do this. I have got to be about this. And why does that make any difference? Because of this fact. Oftentimes, the work that God wants to accomplish through us is not painless. Oftentimes, the things that God wants to do in and through our lives, in the circumstances that He calls us to, oftentimes those are very difficult circumstances. Look what he's doing. Elijah is going to tell the king, a guy who with just his spoken word could have Elijah's head cut off. And he goes in to announce, oh, by the way, there's not going to be rain in this nation, not even a drop of dew in the morning for years. That's not easy. That's difficult. How in the world could you go in and have a conversation like that, speaking truth to power like that? Well, it happens when you understand the chain of command. Elijah knew, I don't ultimately answer to this king. I don't ultimately answer to this queen. I ultimately answer to the Lord, and He has given me a task, and I must be about it because I stand before Him. When I first began pastoring, I was 26 years old. I had no pastoral experience. And even though I was steeped in church life, had grown up in church, I think I was actually born in the nursery, even though all that stuff was true, I'd never pastored before. And because of that, every day, at least to some small degree, was like on-the-job training. And there was tons of stuff that I had to figure out as I went along and I experienced things. It was probably within that first year of ministry that it came to my attention that there was a couple in our church, and they were actually in their mid to later 60s, a couple in our church that were living together. And apparently I was like the last of the party to find this out because everybody else in the church knew this. About that, I knew two things. First of all, that God has made clear that that type of relationship outside the confines of marriage is sin. It just is. I knew secondly this, God has called each of us as believers not to live in isolation. We are in this together. This whole Christian thing is a team sport. And we are not simply given the opportunity, we are given the responsibility and the obligation to help hold each other accountable. And so hearing this, it burdened me. It really did. And the thought that I was aware of is this: I need to have a conversation with them. But every time I considered that thought, it was followed with feelings of nausea. Oh man, that'll be tough. I've been here less than a year. What's going to happen if I do something like that? What might the fallout be? What will they say? What if there's a stink that's stirred? What exactly am I going to do? And honestly, months went by, and I said nothing. And periodically, it would come to mind, and I would just again feel sick to my stomach, racked with anxiety and cowardice. I remember one morning, though, I was in the shower, and all of this came to me. And in hindsight, I really believe that this was an impression that the Lord put on my heart, and the thought came to me in this context. Michael, one day you're going to stand before the Lord, and He's going to ask you, why is it that there was somebody under your care that was trapped in sin, but you didn't love them enough to share that with them? What are you going to say then? At that point, I knew exactly what I needed to do. Not because I answered to the church, not because I answered to deacons or a personnel committee, not because I answered to that couple, but because ultimately I answer and will answer before the Lord. And it's ultimately before whom I stand. And when within days, we had a conversation. Was it easy? Was it fun? Not a chance. But I really believe that in that instance, God was able to work through me. He was able to use me. Why? Because finally I understood the chain of command. Ultimately, I, as Elijah did, as you do, you stand before the Lord. You want God to work through your life. You want to use Him in a way that actually, use you in a way that actually counts. You got to understand the chain of command. But there's one more thing you need to understand, and that's this. You've got to be willing to drop the mic. You've got to be willing to drop the mic. Now, this is not a passage that is flush with all sorts of detail. We're kind of given a bare-bones synopsis of the events that occurred. Elijah walks in, he shares the message. Hey, it's not going to rain. It's not going to happen for years. No dew either for a period of years. In fact, it's not going to rain again until I show back up. And what happens? Elijah then walks off the stage. To use a cliche that you may be familiar with, Elijah does a mic drop. Now, if you hear that phrase, odds are you know what that means. And it's when you have a speaker or when you have a singer, you have some performer, and what they have done is so complete, there is nothing more to add to it, and they just drop the mic and they walk off the stage. Isn't that essentially what Elijah is doing? He's got a message. He shares it, drops the mic, and leaves the stage. You say, well, okay, what's the big deal with that? What's notable about that? Again, this is simple, but I believe it to be important. Elijah shares and presents himself as somebody that God is able to work through and speak through. And he shares this message, and he walks out of the palace. He walks off of the stage. That's what he does. It's important to note what Elijah does not do. Elijah does not go over to Ahab and try to put his arm around him and say, listen, I know that's bad news, but listen, it's going to be okay. Somehow, some way, we're all just going to kind of be able to get through this. You know, it's not going to last forever, and as Annie says, the sun comes out tomorrow. Cheer up. It's going to be okay. Elijah doesn't do any of that. He just walks in, he shares the message that God gave him to share, and then he walks away. Why is that significant? Because Elijah does not soften the blow. Elijah, because honestly, and you're aware of this, even the meanest people that you know, oftentimes, especially when it is that they're sharing something that's not easy to hear, when they're having a difficult conversation, human nature kicks in, and it's just our tendency, our inkling to try to say things that kind of minimize it, that try to soften the blow, that round off some of the corners and the edges and make it much more palatable to hear. And oftentimes in doing so, what we do is to minimize and mitigate the truth of what we've just said. We take off all the edges and there's effectively nothing left. What I'm saying is that Elijah does not do that. Again, to use the cliche, Elijah effectively drops the mic and allows the weight of the message to have its full effect. To make a long story short, this past year I was part of this pastor's group. There were about 22 of us, I think, from across the state. It's called Tar Heel Leadership Network, and we would meet one Thursday a month for a year. And in addition to that, there was a leader in the group that served as a coach. We would have a monthly coaching call with him where we could talk about whatever it was that we desired. In addition, this coach that we had would, and it was scheduled, he would show up at each of our churches, and he would, and with his wife, they would experience that particular church, that service, those facilities, as any first-time guest would. The only difference is that after the service, there would be a debriefing time. So it was back in November, and this guy's name was Mike, that Mike and his wife came here to Gate City. I knew that they were coming. Obviously, we didn't announce that. You had no idea that they were going to be here. And they experienced a service. They experienced the buildings, the facilities, the bathrooms, the people, the service, the preaching, everything, just as any first-time guest would. But again, the difference was that after the service, we sat down for a couple of hours and Mike shared with me all of his observations. First of all, let me say, you guys did great. You were wonderful. You were nice and welcoming and hospitable and gracious and informative. They were so thrilled with our buildings and the condition and cleanliness and all of these things. And there were very, very few critical things that he had to say. But he said there was one thing in particular that he noted. He said on that particular Sunday, he was talking to me, and he said the message that day, he said, I thought it was really powerful, and I really felt like God was speaking through you and through his word during that time. He said, you got to the end of the service, and I know what's going on. You're in the process of setting up the invitation, setting up the time where you're calling for a decision. And he said, it was very clear that day. There is a specific decision that you are asking everyone to make. And they're going to decide at that point, I'm either going to do this or I'm not going to do this. And he said, in truth, there was a real tension that was hanging there. And he said, so you are maybe even praying at this point and getting ready to extend the invitation. And then he says, in the background, I hear music playing softly. He said, at that point, my mind turned off what you were saying and I was listening to the music. And my mind started following a song. He said, at that point, I never heard anything else that you said. He said, the effect of that was this. He said, it was like pressing a pressure release valve, that the tension just kind of dissipated, and it made it very easy for someone to say, you know, maybe I'll just kind of pass. He said, that tension is a good thing. Put the message out, share the truth, let there be the tension as God has and is speaking to the hearts of people, and let that tension do and complete its full work. Don't release it, don't minimize it. In essence, what he was saying to me to do is drop the mic. There are some things that God is going to call me and call you to do if we are people that are useful and available in his hands, that he can and he will work through us. And the truth is this, a lot of those things are not going to be easy. They're going to be involving circumstances and conversations that are not painless. They're going to be conversations that sometimes require you to really stiffen your backbone, making you kind of nervous, leading you into circumstances that are anything other than comfortable. The temptation will be for you to do this, but then soften the edges. Mitigate the effect. God's desire in working through me and through you very simply is this. He wants us to do what he has called us to, not a bit more, but also not a bit less. If you want to be somebody through whom God can work, you understand the chain of command. You got to be willing to drop the mic, but then there's one final thing, and that's this. You've got to be prepared for life to be different. You've got to be prepared for life to be different. Elijah shares the message. He walks off the stage, but it seems that he's still in town. But it doesn't seem he's there very long because of what we're told in verse 2. The word of the Lord came to Elijah with some instructions. Depart from here, turn east, hide by the brook Cherith. Why does God want him out of town? Well, because Ahab and Jezebel are going to want to kill him. Now, at first, maybe Ahab and Jezebel would think, well, this nutcase doesn't know what he's talking about. He doesn't even have radar. I mean, so he doesn't know whether there's going to be storms coming or not. But as the days unfold and as the sun comes up every day and things get drier and drier and drier, and the earth gets so scorched that it's just cracking open, he's going to start thinking back about that Elijah character. This is his fault. I'll make him pay. So, aware of the heart of Ahab, God directs Elijah away from that place, out in the middle of nowhere. Things for Elijah are getting ready to be different. He's getting ready to go to a place that almost certainly he's never been to before. It's completely unfamiliar. So there's no familiar sights. His stuff isn't there. Familiar faces aren't there. In fact, there are no other faces. He's going to be out in the boonies all by himself. As he is out there, something else is gone. The stuff that he had beforehand planned to do. You know, even if we don't write it down, every one of us has kind of got a to-do list, things that we want to get to. Maybe he was wanting to paint his bedroom, and now all of a sudden he can't do that. There's not even a bedroom. He's out sitting under a tree. I mean, all the aspirations that he had, the work that he had otherwise been planning to do, he's not going to be able to do because he's going to be out completely by himself out in the boonies. That's going to be different, really different. But to complicate matters, he's out there for this reason. Notice how verse 3, God gives him the instruction. He says, hide yourself. You're aware that you don't need to hide unless someone is seeking, right? Hide and seek. Someone is getting ready to seek him. Ahab and Jezebel are going to be hot on his trail. And so knowing this, God says, you go out there and you hide yourself. Things are getting ready to be different, really different for Elijah. When God begins to work through you, as you make yourself available for him to use, as he begins to work and move, it's going to change things. It's going to change many of the circumstances that thus far you have been experiencing, that you are so familiar with, and that in many ways you may be so comfortable with. It can change relationships. It can change where it is that you live. It can change the amount of money you have. It can change the feelings of comfort and security you have. It can change the amount of time you have. It can change virtually limitless numbers of things. Some of these changes will come in the form of positive things, things that you would put over in the blessing category. But many of these changes may come as unwelcomed guests, viewed to be painful, viewed by you as uncomfortable. I think that's how you would describe Elijah's changes. Out all by himself, out in the middle of nowhere, while the king and the queen have sent and executed a search and destroy mission for him. That's different, really, really different. And we would all probably agree that's also really, really unpleasant. But what I want you to notice is that even in that circumstance, even in adversity, even in discomfort, even in the absence of feelings of security, when God works through you and he begins to change the circumstances you experience, there are silver linings. But what are they? Look at what happens. God told him to go to Cherith, east of the Jordan. And so what does Elijah do? Exactly what God says. And God gives him in verse 4 some instructions. He says, you'll drink from the brook. So this water is good and safe for you to drink from. And then he says, I've commanded the ravens to feed you there. What? The birds are going to feed me? I mean, they're like, come like with a menu? How exactly does this work? Verse 5 says that Elijah did according to the word of the Lord. He went and lived by the brook that's east of the Jordan. Look at verse 6. The ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. Can we just say that's unusual? Oh, well, what's for supper? I don't know, whatever the birds bring. What's for breakfast? I don't know. Hadn't seen the raven yet. I mean, are you saying to me, Michael, you think that ravens actually brought him bread and meat in the evening and bread and meat in the morning? I absolutely do. Why? Because I think God was true when he said in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. A God that can make something out of nothing can cause birds that he made to feed people that he made. Nevertheless, it is a miracle because you're also aware of this. Ravens don't typically feed us. They just don't. And so what is going on is the only category you can put that in is miracle. This is a miraculous act that every single morning Elijah would get up and ravens are coming in and bringing him meat. They're bringing him bread. And then the same thing happens at night. Day after day after day. I don't know about you, I'd kind of like to see that. That's really unusual. That would be an amazing experience. You talk about having a story to tell. That's an amazing story to be able to tell. Elijah was able to tell that story, though. Why? Because of this fact, he made himself useful and available to God. He learned to lean on and depend on him, and God worked through him. And as God worked through him, it's because he understood the chain of command, because he shared what God led him to do, no more and no less. And even when things were different, really different, and in many ways even unpleasant, because of his willingness to lean on God, he was able to see God do what in a million years he would have otherwise never, ever seen. That's the silver lining. That's what I'm telling you. You learn to lean on and depend on him. You present yourself as somebody through whom he can work. When you go into it knowing, hey, whatever it is that he does, however it is that he works through me, it's going to change things. And it may be that that change initially seems to be very negative and adverse to me. The good news is, in that season and in that place, you will see God do things that otherwise you would have completely missed out on. Elijah got to see it because he was somebody that made himself available for God to use. He was able to be someone that God could use because he understood who he was working for. He was willing to share what God led him to, no more and no less. And regardless of how it changed things, he was still willing to follow. That's Elijah's story. What is yours? God was able to work through him. The question is he able to work through you? Will you bow your heads with me? As we've walked through this morning, maybe you would say, Michael, there's on a few levels, this has really struck a chord with me. I know it's ultimately that the Lord that I'm going to stand before one day. But the truth is, I've been very much operating as a people pleaser. And I believe and know that he wants me to operate knowing that I ultimately answer to him. And so there's some stuff, maybe even some difficult stuff, he wants me to be about that I'm going forward going to be about. Maybe it is that you've been somebody that you might have been sharing what God said, but you have so softened the blow. It's lost its effect. And you're saying, you know, that needs to change. Maybe there's something that God's leading you to do, but you're thus far unwilling because you're afraid of how different things are going to be. If this is you, the good news is you're probably, even though this feels kind of awkward, you may feel right now some discomfort, some unease. That's a good thing. Because I don't believe that's me speaking. I believe that's God through His Word and through the power of His Spirit showing you things to be true about yourself. And God does that, and He gives us this feeling of unease because He wants us to do something, because He wants us to make a decision. Elijah decided that come what may, what God calls me to do, I'm going to do it. Will you be that person? Will you be someone that God can actually use? Maybe you need to talk to Him about it this morning. This altar is open. Just a moment, our time of decision is going to begin, and this is your opportunity to respond to what He's saying to you. Maybe he's showing you, hey, you come to church, you've got a Bible with your name on it, you know a lot of answers to a lot of Bible questions, but you don't yet have a personal connection, a personal relationship with me. If that's you, this is your opportunity. Will you come share that with me? Maybe God's leading you to become a part of this church family, and you have seen Gate City and experienced it with its strengths, with its weaknesses. You've been through the discovery process, and you believe, though, this is where God wants me to invest my life and the life of my family. This is your opportunity. Maybe you just need to come and talk to the Lord, and there's a burden you want to leave with Him today. This is your chance. Father, for Your Word, for the power of Your Spirit, we're grateful. And even though it doesn't feel good, oftentimes these feelings of unease and disquiet within our spirits, that's a good thing because so many times that's You at work showing us areas that need to be addressed and things that need to be changed. And so, Lord, the specific ways You're calling us to change, I pray, Lord, for our personal good. But far beyond that, for Your pleasure and for the kingdom's benefit, we'll follow Your lead. We commit this time of decision to You in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask if you would to stand as our praise team leads us in the hymn of invitation. As God has spoken to you, you respond today.
Take up thy cross and follow me. I heard my Master say,